you rest. And so we invite each other to this time of peaceful worship.
It's the wrong one. It's the wrong one.
And we flee for a while from our tasks.
We hide ourselves for a little space from the turmoil of our thoughts.
Come, cast aside your burdensome cares and put aside your laborious pursuits.
We give our time to God and rest in God for a little while.
Let us join now in singing our opening hymn, number 534 in the red hymnals.
Wait for those.
After we hear the chimes.
Do we have the song? Page 534. Tonight, we share a confession. We confess how tightly we cling to the pain in our lives and how it clouds our sight of God's grace and love in our midst. For those who would surrender, let us join our voices in the following confession. Holy and gracious God, you have searched us and you know us, and so you know how difficult it is for us to be wholehearted in our celebration of your good news. There are paths of us which will not listen to the angel's song. We believe their tidings of great joy are for some people, but not for us. We grieve, God, and we hold tight to our sorrows. And so we confess not our pain, but our embrace of it and our stubborn refusal of your grace and love. Forgive us, God. Continue to love us, we pray, and help us finally to hear your assurance that you travel beside us and that you will help carry our burdens. Amen. Of assurance and pardon. God hears our cries. God listens to our silent longing. God penetrates the doubts and fears that keep us from hearing the good news of great joy. The Spirit is poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by God's grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Praise God who rescues us and makes us whole.
We light the Advent wreath candles to symbolize the light of Christ that continues to pierce through the darkness of our lives. This first candle we light to remember those whom we have loved and lost. We pause to remember their names, their faces, their voices, the memories that bind them to us in this season. We thank God for these who we have had the honor to love.
May God's eternal love surround them. This second candle we light is to redeem the pain of loss, the loss of relationships, the loss of jobs, the loss of health, the loss of normalcy, of suffering and loss around the world. We pause to gather up the pain of the past and offer it to God, asking that from God's hands we receive the gift of peace. Refresh, restore, renew us, O God, and lead us into your future.
This third candle we light is to remember ourselves this Christmas time. We pause and remember these past weeks and months and even years. The disbelief, the anger, the downtimes, the poignancy of reminiscing, the hugs and handshakes of family and friends, all those who stood with us. We give thanks for all the support we have known.
Let us remember that dawn defeats darkness. This fourth candle is lit to remember our faith and the gift of hope which the Christmas story offers to us. We remember that God, who shares our life, promises us a place and time of no more pain and suffering. Let us remember the one who shows the way, who brings the truth, and who bears the light. Let us join in our hymn of response on page 216 or on the screens.
Mean from tender stems.
hear these words from Isaiah 40, verses 1 and 2, 25 to 31. Comfort, comfort, O my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double all her sins, double for all her sins. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. Not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Let us join in a responsive reading of Psalm 121. I raise my eyes toward the mountains. Where will my help come from? God won't let your foot slip. Your protector won't fall asleep on the job.
No, Israel's protector never sleeps or rests.
The Lord is your protector. The Lord is your shade right beside you.
The sun won't strike you during the day, neither will the moon at night.
The Lord will protect you from all evil. God will protect your very life.
The Lord will protect you on your journeys, whether going or coming, from now until forever from now.
I wonder as I wonder. If Jesus had wanted for any wee thing, a star in the sky or a bird on the wing, or all of God's angels in heaven for to sing, he
Hear now these words from the first chapter of John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory, the glory as of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth.
In going through life, we prefer things to be rather simplistic, either one way or the other, either this way or that, either right or wrong, either good or bad. But when it comes to the complexities of life, it's never quite so easy. And the holidays in particular can be very complex for us, especially when there is loss. Loss of a marriage, loss of a dream, loss of good health, loss of normalcy, loss of a loved one. We've all lived with loss in one form or another, especially during this enduring time of the pandemic. Sometimes it's hard to live in the midst of loss when the world is wishing us a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. What are we supposed to do with our grief and sorrow, our regret and heartache, our pain and suffering in the midst of merry and happy? Following the death of her son, Kathy Escobar wrote a book entitled A Weary World, Reflections for a Blue Christmas, sharing how difficult it can be living in such a cut and dry world with such binary choices. She tells how their family carried a whole birth of conflicting feelings in their hearts and souls. Feeling bad for feeling good, smiling in pictures, laughing when their hearts were broken. These are examples of paradox, when things contradict one another, exist in the same place at the same time. We want things to be one way or the other, like a pendulum swinging to the left or the right with no rest in the middle. Escobar offers a way to move beyond the notions of either or, right or wrong, good or bad. What became transformative for her family was to embrace paradox. To live with the both and, the good and the bad, the this and the that. It's not easy though. Embracing paradox requires practice. Even in the darkest days of losing our son, Escobar wrote, there was and is light, people's tenderness toward us, whispers of love, hugs from the kids, the unconditional love of the dog, the sunrise every morning. These glimmers mixed in with the worst of the worst. And she writes how it sustained them. In Leonard Cohen's anthem, he has a line, there is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. When we practice embracing paradox, we give ourselves permission to see and experience those places in our lives that are good, even in the bad times. To be able to feel happy, even in the times of sorrow and grief. Even when there are just slivers of good. So looking for light doesn't mean that we minimize or dismiss or rationalize the dark. We don't try to squeeze it only to focus on the good somehow. Or toss in a few scriptures maybe to make it all better. Rather, it's about allowing the dark and the light to exist together, the hard and the good, the beauty and the mess, the peace and the chaos, the hope and the despair. Love and hate coexisting in our own lives, in the people around us, and in the wider world. We don't have to look too closely at the life of Jesus to see how he embraced the both and, rather than the either or. His birth doesn't make sense in some ways and brings it all together in other ways. It's ugly and smelly, but it's also beautiful and hopeful. And 3 decades later, Jesus, the one who was supposed to save the day with kingly strength and might, dies on a cross, leaving so many more, even more confused. The essence of the Jesus story is that we rise by descending. It's a mystery, yet it's simple. It's easy to talk about, but it's hard to live out. Escobar says, embracing paradox can help us learn to accept all parts of ourselves instead of rejecting our weaknesses or being mad at God or ourselves for not fixing ourselves quick enough. Embracing paradox can help us develop keener eyes to see together the beauty and the ugliness and all of the other wild contradictions that exist, to see them together in other people instead of just focusing on one or the other. Embracing paradox can help us increase the capacity for grace for ourselves and for others. And there is no downside to cultivating more grace in this harsh world of ours. Embracing paradox can help us stop setting ourselves up in relationships where we're the all good or the all bad person. Embracing paradox can help us develop resiliency that is impossible when we otherwise demand things to be either or. We can see joy in the suffering, peace in tribulation, and wholeness and healing in the midst of brokenness. And finally, embracing paradox can help us widen our ability to intersect with people very different from us. And this is essential for a life of incarnational living. I'm guessing you don't need me to tell you about paradox, though. You've been holding contradictory things together for some time, haven't you? Holding them in your story, wrestling with them perhaps. It's usually the embracing part of us, embracing part of paradox that catches us though, because it's easier to talk about it, to intellectualize it, than to draw it in the deep crevices of our hearts and our lived experiences. On this longest night of the year, we remember that there is light in darkness, beauty in the ugly, peace in the chaos, and hope in the despair. On this longest night of the year, we remember that there is one who understands the paradoxes of our lives and determined to be with us through taking on flesh, dying on a cross, and rising again. Emmanuel, my friends, God is with us. May a weary world rejoice. Amen.
Following the spoken prayer, you will be invited to come forward and light a small candle in memory or honor of a loved one, or perhaps a situation in your life that you wish to name that needs to have light shown into it. I'll be lighting a candle, one at least, in memory of my father-in-law, Virgil Avey, who died this past summer. We are reminded that when our hearts are broken, God's heart breaks for us. When we weep, God weeps. Before taking your seat, please take a blue stone off the table, symbolic of God's tears. We join our hearts in prayer to the one who loves us and understands our current circumstances. Please respond each time when you hear God hear our prayer with, "And in your mercy, answer." Let us pray. In the spirit of this season, let us now confidently ask God for all the things we need. For ourselves, as we participate in whatever way we can this Christmas, God hear our prayer.
And in your mercy, answer. For our families and friends, that they may continue to help and support us.
God, hear our prayer.
God, hear our prayer. And in your mercy, answer.
For the person we have loved that has died, for all the losses that we know, jobs, relationships, health, and others that we name in our hearts. God, hear our prayer.
And in your mercy, answer. For all our family and friends, that they may know love and peace and happiness in you. God, hear our prayer. And in your mercy, answer.
For the peace proclaimed by the Christmas angels to come throughout the whole world, God, hear our prayer.
And in your mercy, answer.
In God's extravagant mercy and love, you are welcome to come and light a candle. Perhaps if you're watching at home, you would like to light a candle as well. I want to just mention that we have some wooden lighters up here that you may light at this candle, and then you're welcome to extinguish them here in this.
Thank you.
go. Beautiful, the light, isn't it? Lovely. Let us pray. God of great compassion and love, thank you for listening to the prayers of your people. May the light of your love shine into all the cracks of our places. Grant to all, especially the bereaved and troubled ones this Christmas, the blessing we ask in the name of Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us lift our voices in singing our closing hymn, number 210.
Waiting to see the bride.
As we prepare to go out from this place, let us join our voices one last time in sharing these words of the benediction together. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may you be held in the warmth of God's hand. Amen. Go in peace.